Welcome to our 70th edition of 805 Sports Talk. Kenny Cress is to my right, Lorenzo Reyna's to my left. We got an action-packed show for you guys this week, starting with what happened over the weekend with Karlos and Jose Balderas. If you were following me on Twitter or checking out our website throughout the weekend, I was in Bakersfield, beautiful Bakersfield, that is, to see Karlos and Jose both win their boxing matches. They fought on the undercard of the Victor Ortiz-Saul Corral main event. It was a lot of fun, a lot of excitement there. Karlos won via a first-round knockout of Eder Fajardo, just a quick body shot, and that gave Karlos his second pro win. I caught up with Karlos after that victory. He was backstage with Fernando Vargas, a famed boxer from Ventura County, who was there giving him some tips. I caught up with Karlos. He talked about his win and what he has planned for his next bout, which is coming up in October.
Were you expecting to get a shot like that in to end it quickly? What did you see to end that fight?
I was, my coaches had studied his film and they noticed that he likes to open himself a little too much in the body. And all he was doing was just waiting for me. You know, I noticed that he was just trying to counter. So what I did was I set him up on top and And when he thought I was going up on top, I feinted downstairs and I hit him right in the liver and that was it.
He had to wait a little bit for the fight to start with being on TV, but a lot of people are cheering your name. You got a lot of family here. How did that feel to see so much support here?
I can't put into words how grateful I am for the people behind me. My city, I always carry with me. We're going to rise together, you know, and I truly believe that me and my family and my team are headed towards big things, and never will I forget about my people because they were there for me when I had nothing, so that's that.
You have Fernando Vargas back here, you know, filling you in, kind of keying you up a little bit. What's that like to have a guy like that giving you some advice?
Man, it was a blessing, man. I'm truly grateful because Fernando Vargas, I'm sure a lot of people know, but he was my favorite fighter of all time. I've said it in every interview that they've asked me. This guy was truly, truly an inspiration to me. And to have him walk me out, never would I have imagined it. But, man, I'm so, so thankful. And I'm looking forward to the future.
You got a fight in October at Staples Center, I believe. How are you going to prepare for that fight? Taking any time off? You getting right back into another camp? What's next for you?
I'm only thinking of taking about maybe no longer than a week off because as you can see, the fight was short, but the camp was a lot hard. We had a lot of hard sparring, and you know, we had a lot of weight, you know, all the miles, my knees and my feet, you know, they were kind of tired. So I'm just looking to take a couple days off, and I'll be back in the gym maybe by the ending of next week or beginning of next week.
Last thing, your brother's about to fight later on tonight. How do you feel about that one? Is it nervous seeing your brother fight? How do you feel about seeing your brother?
Yeah, man, I'm more nervous for my brother than I am for myself, to be honest. And my brother's ready. He's prepared. You know, we've had a great, great camp. Like I said, my brother's prepared physically and mentally.
So Karlos won his second pro fight, and it took about 90 seconds for him to win. His brother, who followed that up, had quite a different night in the ring, facing Don Jose and making his professional debut. Jose Balderas took four rounds. So now Jose has just one professional fight under his belt, but he has about twice as many rounds as his brother Karlos has had, because Karlos has two first-round KOs. So Jose had a pretty interesting fight. He has a much different style than his brother. He seems much more aggressive, kind of a free-willing fighter. Karlos, on the other hand, seems more composed, picks his shots a little bit better, is a patient fighter, maybe a little more classically skilled than Jose. Jose is more of a brawler from what I saw Sunday night against Don Jose. He's a pretty physical guy. He can defend himself on the ropes, can fight off the ropes, can turn his opponent into the ropes. And I saw a lot of Jose, you know, because he had a four-round unanimous decision, and all Karlos has had so far were two knockouts. I did follow Karlos closely at the Olympics, and I think it's really funny how their styles contrast so much, with Jose being so physical and, you know, throwing a lot more punches than Karlos, who's a little more tactical in what he does. But I think they both have bright futures. I think Jose is going to be kind of, you know, won't really base his career on boxing. Karlos, you know, that's probably his future. Jose seems like he doesn't take it as seriously. He likes to have fun in the ring, likes to throw with his opponent. Karlos is more, you know, single-minded, focusing on a victory. I think Jose kind of prefers to put on a good show, and that's what was happening Sunday night. The crowd was really lively watching Jose fight and chanting his middle name, Rudy, throughout the bout. You know, he was kind of egging his opponent on, asking for his best shot. He was smiling in the ring, see a lot of that. when Karlos is in the ring, you see more of a, you know, he's all business, wants to just dominate his opponent, while Jose likes to have a little bit fun in there. So it was good to see both of them get a victory. It's going to be a lot of fun to see what they have planned next for their futures. Like I said, with Karlos, he's going to be fighting at Staples Center on October 7th. So definitely keep an eye out for those guys and what their future holds. But if you're a boxing fan on the Central Coast, be sure to tune in any chance you get when these brothers are on the card. So that was my weekend in Bakersfield. Saw a lot of good fighting. Got to mention the Victor Ortiz victory, which is a big knockout that he had. So he might be on the comeback trail. And getting to meet Fernando Vargas was a big highlight. There he is with Karlos. And, you know, that's Karlos's favorite fighter, as you heard in that interview. So he had a big weekend. Big weekend for the Balderas brothers and that family. Moving on to Lorenzo, you know, you're our Lompoc guy, and we got a lot of stuff scheduled for Friday in Lompoc, and you covered some big news last week in the Lompoc Valley. What's going on Friday night with you?
Well, fourth annual Cabrillo Hall of Fame dinner, and they're going to be inducting 8 new members into the hall, and there's some really prominent names. I want to start with Derek Argel. For anybody who follows the water polo landscape, he was a really distinguished and renowned water polo player from Cabrillo. Unfortunately, his life was cut short during his tour in Iraq while serving our country, and he's going to be honored on this night. Dan H. Duffy, who we all know is the father of Danny Duffy, he's going to be honored. So there's that aspect. Bob Lawrence, who coached Derek Argel in water polo and also was best known for leading Cabrillo to the 1996 CIF boys water polo title, he's going to be inducted into the Hall of Fame. One of the more prominent names, I believe, is getting inducted is Carrie Larson. She is a longtime teacher and counselor, but she was a very, very staunch advocate of Title IX and wanting to see more female-driven sports, more team-oriented female sports. And she was responsible for helping bring in sports like softball, like basketball, just helping change the landscape. And talking to Ms. Larson, she got really emotional when discussing her Hall of Fame induction. It's almost as if, like, all those years of fighting for Cabrillo and fighting for female sports at Van Rick Village, finally she's getting that honor and that recognition that she deserves.
Yeah, reading those stories, you did a great series on all those inductees. It was great. And those sound like a really great class at Cabrillo, kind of the backbone of what they have over there with Dan Duffy being a coach, you know, being so involved with a number of programs there. You mentioned Carrie Larson, who's done a great job as kind of on the alumni side, booster side. So, you know, he did a great job profiling all them, and they have a great class coming in this year.
And crazy thing is that Lawrence and Larson, they're still heavily involved with Cabrillo. I mean, it's like Cabrillo hasn't left their blood veins just yet. I mean, I see Bob Lawrence helping out at basketball and baseball games. I see Dan H. Duffy a lot as well. Sometimes he exercises his vocal cords with announcing. Carrie Larson's still heavily involved. I also want to mention Mark Hall, who was a state qualifying wrestler at Cabrillo. He eventually moved into bigger and better things as a fire chief in Anchorage, Alaska.
We also have the Noah Scott golf tournament on Friday over there in Vandenberg Village. So if you're still wanting to hit the links, be sure to check that out. We'll have some coverage on that as well. Also based in the Lompoc Valley, you profiled two guys who are on the defensive and offensive lines kind of for Lompoc last year, moving over to Hancock. Can you kind of fill us in on that story?
Yeah, Isaac Black and Trenton Carter, I mean, they were all LPL standouts, and they were two of the three anchors of that defensive line, that same defense that had so many shutouts and limited so many points. But, you know, in talking to Black and Carter, I mean, there's this vibe that I get that they're a lot more enthusiastic about their roles in the Hancock defense, because one of the things that they mentioned that stuck out with me is that in Lompoc's defense, they had to do a lot of inside and outside containment, but more so inside because it was a three-man front. In this one, this particular case, with Hancock being a four-man front, all they have to worry about is just sealing the outside, so they're true defensive ends. And to the liking of Carter and Black, more so Black because of how undersized he was, he now is in a situation where he gets to see a lot more one-on-one. He doesn't have to worry about a tight end over the top. I mean, it's just him and the tackle going at it in this particular scheme. So these guys are really energized. So they give me a reason to follow Hancock this upcoming year.
Yeah, you did a great job on that story, talking about what they plan on doing on the field. You mentioned, you know, techniques and, you know, what gap they're going to be, you know, focusing on. But you also kind of talked about their story and how they were almost going. I know Trenton was almost going to Moore Park, and then, you know, kind of thought it through, talked to some of his coaches, and ended up at Hancock. And it seems like, I think that's always a good choice to, you know, do what's best for you. Don't go rushing out to a different city and a, you know, more difficult living situation. Maybe it is better to stay home. So I think it might work out in their
best
interest.
Same was the case for Isaac Black. And one of the prominent quotes that Carter gave me was, he didn't want to be in a situation where he's living with six guys and he has no clue who these guys are. And I'm sure you know, Moorpark's a very expensive area. Mm-hmm. I mean, that whole side of California, Ventura County, very expensive area. From what I remember, Chris Dutra actually played at Moorpark mm-hmm. College, but even then, he tells a lot of his players now, especially the local players he tries to recruit, that, you know, it's overrated to leave your house right after high school and play somewhere else. I mean, sometimes those guys end up coming back because they realize how pricey it can get, or maybe they're fighting for playing time. So, I mean, in the case of Carter and Black, or just Lompoc in general, they continue that pipeline to Allan Hancock College. Mm-hmm.
And we know Dutra likes the Central Coast. He went to Santa Maria High School, and he's been the head coach at Hancock for a long time. So, you know, he's going to be a candidate for you to stay
and
on
the
Central
Coast. And he's also getting RJ Grice, who was one of the standout offensive linemen from mm-hmm. Lompoc this past year.
That Lompoc pipeline to Hancock mm-hmm. is serious, and those guys usually work out. Moving to you, Kenny, we had an interesting Friday. You know, you're like, training camps are, you know, starting to get underway, so I'll probably swing by some schools and see what's going on. So you swung by St. Joe and ran into three St. Joe grads, and then you saw that they were, you know, practicing later on. What was going on at St. Joe on Friday?
Right. As you said, I was driving around looking for any football training camps that might be a session, and go up to St. Joseph, and there they were, Curry Parham, Joe Guzman, and Chris Bargner. They all three were teammates at St. Joseph at one time, although they're all different graduating classes in high school. And Curry and Chris were teammates at Hancock before they all went their separate ways to four-year schools. They were working out informally together at St. Joseph High School. Curry is going back for another season at Tabor College in Kansas. Curry said the small town life was fine with him, didn't have to fight for parking, gas is a lot cheaper. Chris is also going off to New Adventure, Midwest Nebraska, Chadron State, which is kind of in the northwestern part of the state. And Joe, he went to Redlands, decided that he wants to eventually play for a bigger school, a Division I or II school. So he decided to go the junior college route. He landed at Ventura College. He said the reason why he chose that was he liked the offense. He thought the offense was wide open, more wide open than at some other schools. And after I talked to them, I talked to Jim Shavala, the new St. Joseph head coach, but he's been in the St. Joseph system for a while. He coached for a long time at Bakersfield, has a lot of friends at Bakersfield, but really likes it out on the Central Coast, doesn't miss the overlong summers back there at all. He said Bakersfield High was going to pads for the first day on Monday, and they were going at 5:30 in the morning to beat the heat. Yeah. He seemed very enthusiastic about his upcoming first year as head coach at St. Joseph, and he has a lot of good returning players. He lost a lot of good players from last year, but he also has some good returning players. So, should be an interesting year. Mm-hmm.
Reading your profile on Shavala is definitely a guy you can root for, especially me. You know, I got a lot of ties to Bakersfield, and Bakersfield High has always been one of my favorite high school programs, knowing he coached there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, some of the things that he went through while there, losing his son as a coach over there and coming here, is definitely a guy that you can root for. And it was a great story that he's now the head coach. And
they hung his son's jersey. That was neat, mm-hmm. I thought. Mm-hmm. It's number 25. I mean, well, they hung his jersey.
Yes, he's definitely seems like a through-and-through football guy. And we're all rooting for him to have a great season. And you mentioned they do lose some players. When you lose guys like Fenton Will and C.J. Cole, you know, that's a loss. But you know, seeing them practice a little bit last week, I think they could definitely do some things this year, and they definitely have a really nice core. They've actually added some pieces with the Miller boys from Mission Prep over there, so I think St. Joe's in for a pretty good year.
Yeah, Dino Maldonado back, and Nate Guzman's back, some other key players.
Zach Morris, Jaden Vargas, yeah, I think there are definitely some pieces there. So I wouldn't be surprised if St. Joe has another solid year and maybe challenges Lompoc in the LPL. Who knows how that's going to turn out, but I think, you know, definitely looking up, still looking up for St. Joseph with the new coach there and Dustin Davis no longer being there, but I wouldn't be surprised if they have another solid year. And that brings us to our final topic, which is Media Day, and that's coming up this weekend. St. Joseph has hosted it 3 years now, so we appreciate all their help in hosting another one this year. And it's a lot of work, but it's a lot of excitement. So first off, thank you to all the coaches who have been cooperating with us over the last 3 years. We have some new coaches this year, so hopefully we'll all have a good time this weekend at our Media Day. Lorenzo, I'll go to you. What are you looking forward to? Are there any storylines you want to hear more about? Any coaches you want to talk to? Any players you want to meet? What are you most looking forward to this year's Media Day?
My first Media Day. Let's start there. But, you know, I'm looking forward to experiencing everything. I mean, it's crazy because being in the Central Valley, you hear all those stories about how deep and how talented those schools are. They never have a high school Media Day. If you hear about Media Day, it's usually for Fresno State. But, you know, it's great that this is put together because there are some great teams in this area. And, I mean, getting to know A.J. Pateras at Cabrillo, who looks like he's going to be first on deck with his team, talking to the Lompoc guys about, you know, the scrutiny they have going into Division III with Newberry Park, Sierra Canyon, a very loaded D3 slate. Also getting to know Orchid Academy as well. Mm-hmm. Orchid Academy's put together some fine seasons in the 8-man front, so getting to know them as well. So really looking forward to it.
Yeah, Kenny, anything you're looking forward to for Media Day, and how do you feel about the big day coming up?
Just seeing who has some of the most returning players who might have to, not exactly start over again, but also there are several schools that have a lot of returning, several mm-hmm. prominent returning players, such as Lompoc, Santa Maria, St. Joseph. Sainez lost all everything quarterback Mike McCoy, but they have all everything wide receiver Gabe Prendergast mm-hmm. coming back. Mm-hmm. So it should be interesting. I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah, usually it's one of the most exciting times of the year for all the teams. You know, they all have that glimmer of hope that they're going to make the playoffs, battle for league championships. So it's an exciting year for them and for us on the press side, meeting so many of the coaches and players and seeing who's going to be some breakout stars. You know, like before last year, we didn't know how good of a guy Gabe Prendergast was going to be. He had a pretty good sophomore year, but his junior year was insane. And then looking at Lompoc, Shamar Savage really broke out onto the scene last year. So I'm kind of looking forward to, you know, maybe seeing who's going to be a breakout guy that we didn't know about last year. We kind of knew about Prendergast and Savage a little bit, but they really had breakout seasons. Isaiah Garcia at Santa Maria, Blake Truitt at Santa Maria, Robert Ruiz at Santa Maria, they all had breakout seasons. So, you know, I'm kind of interested to see who might be that breakout star this year.
It looks like they're all back.
Yeah. They're all back.
Yeah, we have a lot of great returning players. And that's what we're excited about. So be sure to check us out for Media Day. Over the weekend, we'll be at St. Joe, and we'll be publishing that coverage throughout the next couple of weeks until the season starts on Friday, August 25th. So thank you guys for tuning in to another edition of 805 Sports Talk.